Apiayam to be part of this August panel and to be afforded an opportunity to express my humble views on the important theme, constitutional reform, to court brave change or to leave well enough alone. I thank the organizers of this event for their kind invitation. I wish to make it abundantly clear from the outset that the comments, opinions, and views which I express here this evening are my own and not those of the People's Progressive Party, of which I am an executive member. Within recent times, we have seen and heard public calls for constitutional reforms emanating from various quarters. The recently formed local group RISE identifies constitutional reform as its very raison d'etre. The Carter Center desires to see constitutional reform. The British High Commissioner has expressed his government's disappointment at this slow movement towards constitutional reform. Constitutional reform was a major plank of the APNU-AFC manifesto at the 2015 general and regional elections. Constitutional reform has long been a staple in the lexicon of political and social commentators alike when they offer their prognosis to the many political and social ills which they diagnose in our society. I get the clear impression that some believe that the term constitutional reform has a particular intellectual ring to it and abuse and misuse it as a panacea for every wrong in this society. Our Constitution is the supreme law of our country. Its provisions not only seek to capture our aspirations, ideals, and national goals, but most importantly, are aimed at regulating public affairs and the role and responsibility of public officials and institutions. It lays the foundation for an inclusive democratic governance for our country. Academics and jurists alike have often described constitutions like ours as organic and alive. I subscribe to this view. Therefore, like any other law, nay, more than any other law, our constitution must necessarily remain dynamic and under constant review with a view of reform so that it can adapt to meet the exigencies of a changing and evolving society. Therefore, the nature and magnitude of constitutional reform must be driven and determined by the society itself in which the constitution operates. I apprehend that the reform contemplated by the calls to which I have made reference are manifold and of a fundamental nature. The last major set of constitutional reforms occurred in Guyana in 2001. Where about 200 fundamental changes were made to the then constitution. Has our society evolved so drastically over the ensuing 17 years to precipitate the monumental constitutional reforms which are now being contemplated? I do not see the cogent and compelling reasons being advanced for constitutional reform. Neither do I see the efficacious proposals of the reforms themselves. In my view, only when these two sets of information become available for scrutiny that one can make an informed decision on the matter. Therefore, I have questions. Are we being pushed to constitutional reform because of foreign influences? Have we convinced ourselves that our constitution and the breadth of its provisions do not meet the needs of the people of Guyana and are therefore ineffective and unworkable? When we consider constitutional governance, we are looking at obedience by our leaders to the rule of law. When, therefore, public officials comply with constitutional measures and prescriptions, there is no room for challenge to their actions on the ground of a want of constitutionality. Problems, however, arise when public officials either deliberately or out of ignorance violate the provisions of the Constitution. It is in these circumstances that some are wont to say that provisions of our Constitution are ineffective and unworkable. I, however, respectfully submit that deliberate violations of or noncompliance with the provisions of the Constitution in governmental affairs by public functionaries do not equate to the ineffectiveness or unworkability of the scheme of our Constitution, justifying an ill-considered rush to constitutional reform. So the Constitution insulates service commissions from any direction or influence from any other body or authority. However, it is now public knowledge that in two successive years, two different ministers of government wrote to two different service commissions purporting to issue directions to them from His Excellency the President not to proceed with the discharge of their constitutional duties, a clear violation of the Constitution. Does this render the Constitution ineffective and unworkable to justify its reform? I think not. And on this particular issue, what are we reforming the Constitution to achieve? Would it be to remove the protective insulation with which these commissions are closed so that they can now be actually be directed and influenced by extraneous bodies and authorities? I hope not. I am not oblivious to the fact that one of the major components of the reforms which are being canvassed seek to constitutionalize an arrangement for executive power sharing between and among major political parties of our country. A most noble ideal indeed. But do the level of maturity, trust, and magnanimity, which are the prerequisites for such an arrangement to work, exist in our political environment? Let us quickly examine two instances to appreciate what the current realities are. There is no greater constitutional expression of political power sharing in our constitutional, in our current constitutional matrix than firstly the appointment of the Chief Justice and Chancellor of the Judiciary. And secondly, the appointment of a chairman of GCOM. In respect of all these appointments, the Constitution mandates processes which require the pivotal input of both the leader of the opposition and the president. In respect of the two judicial appointments, they require the agreement of the leader of the opposition before the president can appoint. Since this provision was introduced into the Constitution in 2001, no appointment has ever been made. Successive leaders of the opposition withheld their agreement from the appointment of the incumbent holders of those offices. Not a reason was ever given. In relation to the appointment of a chairman of GCOM, a list of six names must originate from the opposition leader to the president for him to select one for appointment. 18 names have been submitted by the leader of the opposition over the last 9 months. An appointment is still to be made. A hitherto seamless and straightforward constitutional process has suddenly become complex, complicated, and controversial. Simple and clear language of the Constitution has suddenly become obscure, ambiguous, and equivocal. Those are our current realities. Whether executive power sharing can work in this atmosphere is anyone's guess. Hence, in my view, at this juncture, the need for constitutional compliance trumps the need for constitutional reform. Thank you.